You're listening to Ka-Pow, the pop culture podcast. Comics, television, movies, and more. If it impacts fan culture, we have something to say about it. And now, your hosts, Jordan, Cliff, and Seth.
Hello, everybody. Welcome back to Ka-Pow, the pop culture podcast. My name is Jordan Lowe.
Cliff Barnes.
I'm Seth.
We have our favorite guest in the house. The OJ is here. Jesse Starcher. Jesse
is a friend. What's up, guys? I'm so excited.
Love when that theme music comes rolling in there.
I'm looking forward to this episode. I can't wait. Cannot wait to have a little discussion.
That does remind me. I forgot all about this. I was at lunch today during work, and it was Friday, so I thought, oh, I'm just going to go grab something. I need to get gas in the truck. I'm going to run down the Kroger and get some gas. And I thought, well, I'll just hop across the street, go to Arby's, and pick up lunch. And I was sitting there and in the drive-thru line waiting my turn, and I hear a familiar voice over there next to me ordering, and I hear, no ranch, no ranch. And I look over, and it's Coach Mayer sitting there. And I said, no ranch. And he just kind of looked at me real funny, like, who's making fun of me?
So. Oh, the wacky guests we have. Well, we're back to close out our summer box office contest we did. We set it up there, 4 months ago or something? I don't even remember. What episode was that, Jordan?
Go back in the archives to episode 374.
374.
May 15th. It was just the start of summer back in May. Gosh,
we were so young.
Man.
We were looking forward. The world was bright and cheery, and now summer's over. Fall is here. And we're all wrong.
We're all wrong.
All our grand predictions have proven false.
Yeah. I went back and listened to prepare for this, and I'll say it is, it pays off. You go back and just see how wrong we were as we predicted each of our top 10 lists for the summer box office. And there's a, you can also listen and hear all the rules, how the scores are calculated and such. We're going to break it down tonight, tell you what the actual top 10 biggest grossing movies domestically in the United States over that time from, what was it, Memorial Day to Labor Day.
Yeah.
And cut it off there, and we will see who was the closest to, you know, getting it right, who got the points needed to win the contest, and they will get to wield a very powerful weapon at the end of this podcast. So yeah.
I remember us being very excited about the upcoming summer of movies.
And, yes. which I will say we all won there because yeah. It was quite a summer of movies.
Oh, you guys had your movie passes. You were
Yeah. We mentioned that in that episode. I was like, you know, there's this thing happening, and and it, people perked up. Cliff came, jumped in.
I did
with me, and we spent the summer just going to the theater constantly. It was great. It's great. So that worked out without a hitch. By the way, that was a.
Yeah,
that good thing, awesome. A Regal Unlimited. That was awesome.
That was a fine choice, because otherwise there is no way I would have seen half the movies I saw this summer. So,
right.
Yeah, I thoroughly enjoyed it. It was well worth the $20 a month, and with that, you know, you build up your points and you get free drinks and popcorns and upgrades and stuff like that. It was totally worth it. I hated to cancel after my 3 months were up, but I just didn't have a long list of movies to see.
It's
anymore.
Only worth it if you know when to get out.
Right.
So, regardless of all our predictions, we're gonna find out what really happened, and then I'll sprinkle in what we had picked. And
you know what? I don't feel too bad because we all made big mistakes. We all, none of us knew. It's too unpredictable.
Yeah.
Even the pundits who are paid to do this don't really know what's going to happen. The forecasts and the projections, they're always wrong. So
true.
Very surprising summer of movies.
Yes. It was crazy. It was crazy. It's clear. It's crazy because I will say in retro, you know, us looking back, I mean, we're just like, it's almost like, how did we not know that this would happen? but we did not. Go back and listen. So let's not bury the lead. The number one movie at the box office this summer was Barbie. Barbie, guys.
Yeah.
Unbelievable.
Maybe we could have, maybe we could have used a female in this movie.
Yes. Yeah.
That's true.
We talked about how it had potential. We did, you know, there's a chance something's going to happen here. People are talking about, Jordan talked about the memification of it. Jesse argued how, no, there's no story. There's no story. It's all, it's just a thing. It's impossible.
Right. Right.
This can't happen. It's not a thing, you know, and really adamant. And, you know, Cliff came in there and said, and, you know, felt stronger than any of us. He was willing to put it as high as 6 on his list. I put it at 8. Jesse put it at 10. And I really want to give Jordan credit for this quote. Every year, something clicks. And everyone says, wow, women go to the movies. That sounds pretty good, except Jordan was talking about the movie Joyride. That he thought
both of which I put that and Barbie as my dark horse.
Yeah, so yeah.
One did click, yeah. One didn't. I was right. I was half right.
Yeah. Barbenheimer had not been coined yet when we did our podcast.
Oh man!
And the phenomenon that resulted from that, it was insanity at the box office. Barbie made $612 million, almost $612.5 million, basically. So, and that's a lot. It's a lot, guys. we did not have that on our radar. It was crazy. Yeah. I loved it. And
when you look at the year before, was Top Gun. Right?
Yeah.
Top Gun Maverick?
Yes.
The machismo, you know? Yeah. And now all of a sudden, it's like a complete 180 with Barbie as the top movie. It's crazy.
Feminists have won, guys. They've taken all the good stuff away from
us. Absolutely. So maybe someone will get that message that Jordan was talking about, that, you know, you might want to cater to all audiences and make some more of these female-driven movies. You know, we did kind of talk about how, you know, it might be something special, Greta Gerwig being involved, and that hopefully she was going to do something good with it, and she did. They came up with their own story, and they did find a lot of things to base it on, off of the Barbie franchise and the characters and the outfits and the I'm Beach and all the little things they could squeeze out of it and really make it a poignant film. So I thought it was awesome and deserved to be a great big hit. And we were all wrong.
Yeah. Absolutely. My favorite movie of the summer.
Yeah.
Nothing came close to it.
I don't know if I get that far, but I did love it.
It was great.
Let's just move on to number 2. Well, I do want to point out there that Cliff is in the lead there. If you'll notice, Cliff had it at 6. That was
my best prediction of the whole thing. It's all downhill from here.
I disagree, Cliff. You don't know how close you are. Let's see. At number 2 in the box office, Spider-Verse, Across the Spider-Verse. We were not expecting this. Obviously, none of us would have put it here, except Cliff nails it. He put it exactly at number two.
Wow.
Cliff, who does not like Spider-Man.
No, he does not.
He nails it. Me and Jordan put it at six. And Jesse had it at eight. Jesse, it's looking bad for you.
It does not look good at all, actually. No.
Why do we doubt this? Like, the first one was huge, and these kind of movies, a lot of times the sequels do even better.
Well, that's true.
I will say
the first one did not even make $200 million. Hmm. And I think it was like 175, something like that. We were not prepared for this movie to make $381 million. That is a lot, guys. Wow. That's a lot of money.
Yeah,
we weren't ready for that.
I don't have to like Spider-Man to recognize how popular he is.
I saw it twice. It was probably my favorite movie of the summer. Mm-hmm. I loved it. I love both these movies. You know, these are flukes.
Yeah.
These were quality movies.
Solid. Mm-hmm.
But we somehow we didn't see it. It all looks clear in the rearview mirror. But man, we did not know it's going to. Well, I'm not speaking for Cliff. Cliff knew. Cliff had these much better than the rest of us. So we're going to move on to what at number three, what we all had put at number one on our list was Guardians of the Galaxy 3. Slots in there at position three. No one was expecting two things to be higher than this.
Right.
It made $359 million. $359 million.
Yeah.
That's about what we expected. We didn't think anything was going to go higher than that, really.
Yeah, that's a respectable amount if you were number one.
Yeah. Right. So this was a big money making summer of movies. Like, they made bank. Oh yeah, we all had a number one. So nobody made any headway or lost anything on this one. Cliff still firmly in the lead here after these top three movies. You really did. You guys the amount of money this made, I feel like, just imagine if the word of mouth was better than it was on Guardians of the Galaxy 3. Like, there was a lot of talk about the animal cruelty and things, you know.
Yes. Yeah.
So yeah,
I remember.
I think it could have been much, much bigger.
Yeah, it really surprised me because I did not have a problem or any issues with this movie. I really liked this movie. And it really caught me off guard that anybody had a problem with it, because it's a Marvel movie and it's campy and fun, and yeah, it's got some sad parts in it, but I guess I was expecting some sad stuff anyways, just maybe not in the same form. But yeah, I thought it was really good.
Yeah, I wonder if that impacted like some repeat viewings, like people didn't want to go back two and three times and cry.
Yeah.
Yeah, that might be true. Well, let's just move on here. At number four, I was the only one to put this movie in the top 10. I had it at number nine. No one else even had it in their honorable mentions.
Nope.
And it was at number four, making the most money for a biopic ever. It's Christopher Nolan's Oppenheimer.
This is just unbelievable.
Let's be honest, though.
Had Jordan's quote was, "This is the most likely to underperform."
And put it any other date in the year, 51 other weekends, and it would have.
Yeah,
and we were like, "This is gonna work." It comes out the same weekend as Barbie. It's never gonna work. But neither one's gonna be able to make any money.
I mean, they were comparing this to another pairing of movies. I cannot remember what they were, but it was just a strange phenomenon. Like, hey, I'm going to go watch what you had to make a choice because you're going to watch two movies that weekend. You had to figure out which one you're going to watch first mm-hmm. because you're either going to end the day, you know, happy, or you're going to end the day on a really right. sour note. And it's just such a strange, strange phenomenon. I can't believe that we are talking about two movies that right now we're just talking in the top four that released on the same weekend.
It isn't that insane.
It is.
Number
it
really one is. And number four, same weekend.
Yeah.
We may never see this again. Like
there's no studio employee, there's no marketing executive. No, you couldn't pay anyone enough money to concoct it. It just happened.
That's crazy.
Yeah. This was not a planned phenomenon to capitalize on one thing or the other. Like it was just the perfect storm of events and who could have seen it coming? Not us.
Not us.
No way.
It definitely proved that the movies are alive. Like there's hope for people going to the movies, but you gotta hope that everything falls into place and the right meme hits.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Somebody, whoever coined that phrase needs of Barbenheimer needs to get a little money. That was crazy. It was crazy. Yeah. It made $310 million. That's ridiculous. You know, So
with that being said,
so ultimately $1 billion basically that weekend. Yeah, you know, that for those two movies that came out that weekend on through to Labor Day, $1 billion. Man. It just in the US. Just in the US. Crazy.
With that being said, since that movie didn't make it onto my top 10, that means one of these movies I've got left on my top 10 are not going to be at all in this top 10. So that sucks. All right.
True. True. At least one. Let's see. So still, still Cliff's still looking good. Jesse, no. No. Me and Cliff are looking okay around now. Let's see. Here we go. At number five, Jordan was the closest with this. Not he had the most hope for it. He picked it the highest, is what I mean. He put The Little Mermaid at number two on his list.
Wow.
Jesse and I put it at number three, and Cliff, the Disney guy, said, no, hold, wait. Wait for it. Wait. I'm going to put it at five. And he nails it. Again.
Nice. Disney purist.
Yeah.
That's what he's talking about.
It was a good movie. I enjoyed it. We went and saw it, took my wife and daughter, and I'm pretty sure they cried in a couple spots and we sang along, and it was a fun movie.
It made $298 million.
Yeah, that's a good showing for those live action remakes.
Yeah,
well, they do great. That's the best of them, but they do very well. But just I mean, Cliff with two bullseyes in the top five, he nails them. Andy had one of the other ones in the top five. I mean, he's crushing it now. Not so much for the rest of us here. It's starting to look hopeless, guys. Starting to look hopeless.
I don't know. I'm remembering some of Cliff's other picks.
Yeah.
So. What?
We haven't gotten to the bottom end.
We're building
yet.
Up. We're building up. To...
He's just, I feel like Seth's trying to tell a story here.
So.
The tragic twist.
Yeah.
So at number
fall
six.
Fall from grace.
At number six, I'm going to play that quote I said. I'll just play it. I'll just hit this button right here. Guys, there's going to be a movie that comes in that we're not expecting. It's going to be about freedom or something, and it's going to rule the box office. Boy, was I right. Some movie called The Sound of Freedom that tried the old pay it forward technique where you could buy tickets and people could go on and then go use those tickets to go see it. And there was a little controversy, but I don't know what to make of it, but it's a number six.
I feel like it's a false number.
Yeah. Well, so tell me a little bit. Okay. So the controversy is that they're including these tickets for the pay it forward thing. That's what's,
yes, it was. Oh, it's, there's a lot of legitimacy to it. It really did make this amount of money. People,
yeah, the
did,
tickets
did,
sold. The tickets sold, but that doesn't mean the butts were in the seat.
Yeah. Nobody saw
but,
it.
But that's not, I would be the first to agree that nobody saw it, but that's not true. People went and people used a lot of those tickets. So, the people on the streets, so doing the articles and stuff, everything I read, real, you know, from people I trust, said that a lot more of it was real than you think. These people were out there supporting this movie. You know, they want to have a good showing at the box office. It did have this thing, you know, where they were doing, where they were making sure people would get to go that could, even if they wouldn't normally go to the theater. They were trying to push it, but it had a lot of backing that way. But
yeah, but which that's not what our contest was about, though.
So needless to say, none of us had this on our list. No one in the world had this on their list.
It's like we said, Barbie served an underserved community. Women are hungry for a movie. So there was a community that this movie served that want that type of movie. So that's, it made a ton of money. That's fine. That's good. But it was like, it was presented as like a political act to go to this movie.
Yes.
It was presented as like a moral thing. Show that woke leftist Hollywood, we're going to take them down, that kind of thing. It was like, I don't know, it was using entertainment as a political statement, which I thought they hate that. But hey, what do you,
which they would say that that's what the left does, so they're going to take a piece of it or whatever. Yeah. Whatever, they got to do it. I hope they enjoyed themselves. They screwed up our list.
Yeah, I had no idea.
Cliff was killing it up till this problem. I blame the sound for
him. I do blame it. I think.
Oh, anyway, yeah, it made 180.
I got a problem with this list.
It made about $182 million, which was just enough to edge out our number seven. I put it way too high, apparently. I put it at number two, The Dial of Destiny. I was going for the Top Gun effect, the dad effect.
Yep.
Cliff put it at three.
Mm-hmm.
Jordan put it at five. Jesse was hesitant. He said, I don't know. I don't know, guys. I don't know if people really have this. These kids today have the nostalgia for Indiana Jones. And he knocks an arrow and he hits his first bullseye here and putting it at number seven. Getting some points for that. Yeah, it made $174.5 million. So just about seven shy of Sound of Freedom. Or it had been a little higher.
Yeah, that I wanted it to do better.
Well, you should have went to the theater then.
Okay.
Did you
see
any of these movies in the theater?
No, I was actually looking at this top 10 list and I was like, I didn't see a single one of these in the theater. Oh. So, probably look at the top 10 list of last year and say the same thing.
Okay. Sounds like somebody that doesn't deserve to be in this contest.
Oh, whoa.
Disqualification.
Thank you.
Anybody did we like? I thought Dial of Destiny was pretty good.
I thought it was fun. It made me feel like a kid watching an Indiana Jones film in the theater again. Yeah. I recognized it for what it was, but I thought it was a fun experience. I had a really good time watching this movie.
I was bored through long stretches of it. I thought the action scenes were pretty well done, but everything else just didn't do it for me.
It's no 80s indie.
No.
It's indie in his 80s.
Yes, exactly. So we move on 2, the number 8 biggest domestic box office movie of the summer. Well, let's see. It was a part one, kind of. Mission Impossible, : Dead Reckoning, part one. Made $171 million, just shy of Dial of Destiny. Was not on Cliff's radar. Jordan had it at 4. I had it at 5. Jesse had it at 2. Big hiccup. You were almost in it for a minute there, Jesse, but sorry. Big hiccup there.
Yeah.
I really liked it. I've got a few complaints, but I mean, I really, really dug it. It's a cliffhanger-y movie. I thought the big stunt maybe shouldn't have been. So we shouldn't have known everything that was going to happen in this movie from the trailer that I even mostly avoided. But it was a good time.
If there's anything that I am taking away from this, is how flipped the movie season can be from one year to the next. Because again, see my machismo comment from earlier. Like, the reason I had Mission Impossible up so high was because it was the era of Tom Cruise is back again, baby.
Yeah. And you said, I'm going to be enjoying these points. That's what you said.
Well, now, that guy was pretty foolish to say such things.
But I will say, when you picked Dial of Destiny, nailing it, I have to reiterate, you felt that that was going to be one of your biggest regrets.
Wow.
And because you just heard us all put it higher. And we're the ones regretting it now. Yeah, good movie. Could have made more money. Let's see. But still, every one of these movies in this top 10 list made a bunch of money. Let's see. Number 9. We had Transformers, Rise of the Beast. So Transformers used to rule the summer 15 years ago. Any type of Transformers movie came out, it was always usually number one in the summer. And this one's hung on to stay in the top 10 here. $157 million. So not too far below Dead Reckoning.
Yeah.
That was honorable mention.
Yeah. That was the first one I used my unlimited pass to go see.
Yeah. Nice.
Yeah, Cliff had it as an honorable mention. Jesse had it at 6. Jordan and I had it at 10, and it was at 9. So we were pretty close. So we probably got the most points on that movie there. So still, it's hard to tell. Cliff really had the most bangers here. Jesse had a one bullseye. You know, most of us have been equally inconsistent. at number 10, this was the mess maker of the summer for me. This is another Disney movie, Pixar, Elemental. Let's just start off by saying it opened
terribly.
$29 million.
Yeah, it was a bomb.
It was a bomb.
But it just hung around all summer, didn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. Word of mouth got out.
It's ridiculous. It couldn't hang on just a little bit more. It made $153.5 million to Transformers 157. If it would have made that $3.5 million, we'd have a much different ending here. Yes.
Oh wow.
So,
but that's how movies used to work. Like, now it's also front loaded. If it does, yeah, on what it makes on Friday determines whether it's a hit or not. Mm. Movies used to play for months and months, and you'd hear about it, and like no one was, especially kids. This is a kids movie. Like, kids aren't always in a hurry to get out there on opening weekend or whatever. It's like whenever you have time as a family and whatever. So I do kind of. I like the variety we're getting. I like how many movies, at least till now, have been coming out. But, like, I kind of miss that chance for movies to hang around a while. Mm-hmm. Like, the ones that disappear in a week and a half are not great.
What if this was not on your radar? This Pixar movie, you didn't have it anywhere.
I did not. I just didn't know a whole lot about it, and Pixar had not had a big hit for a while.
Yeah. I had it in my honorable mentions. Jordan had it at 3. Jesse had it at 4. So they each got 3 points for it there. So not too bad. Not too shabby, guys. We'll go ahead and do, let's say, these top 3 and the honorable mentions here. 11, 12, and 13. At 11, Fast 10, Fast X, whatever you want to call it, did not make the top 10.
Yeah.
Pretty crazy.
Wow. I had it high. We all had that in our top 10.
Yeah.
All of us. Made $146 million, basically. That's crazy. At number 12, Flash. That's a problem. I've been waiting all night
for you to say the word Flash.
Right. No kidding. Yeah.
We all had that in our top 10. It did not make it. It opened the same weekend as Elemental, and the Flash opened $55 million to Elemental's 29. And look who's laughing now.
I remember that being my biggest regret, is putting the Flash so low. I think, what I have it at 8. I'm like, oh, I'm really underestimating the Flash, I think.
Yeah. Wow. Yep. But you make quite an argument why it would not do good. You guys, I blame Carly. HBIC,
I remember that.
HBIC, she said no. Mm-hmm. Nobody go. And the world listened.
They really did. Yeah. They really did. She knew it. Finger on the pulse.
That's right. Mm-hmm. And at 13, we had Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. Only had a couple weeks there to make some money, and it made, well, I guess about a month. It made about $108 million, which is really good. It was a really good movie.
It was good. I had it at 8.
Yes, you did. She got a nothing. Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow. Yep. Okay. So, other things we picked. Let's see. My list. What? I didn't have too many wild things. You guys got more wild than me. Let's look at Cliff. Cliff, you got crazy.
You had such
a great start, nailing all these. Then we got up to your 7th pick. You had Flash, didn't make the top 10, which we all did that. Yeah. Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles didn't make the top 10. Blue Beetle didn't make the top 10. Haunted Mansion didn't make the top 10. You had Transformers, your honorable mentions.
Yeah.
So you got a point for that. But Return of the Jedi, it was only out for a week.
It was the 40th anniversary.
And The Machine. Don't forget The
Machine. Now I will say, those picks, 8 through 10, Turtles, Blue Beetle, Haunted Mansion, saw all of them in the theater, and I loved all 3. I thought they were all super solid movies. So even though they might not have made the top 10, I would still highly recommend
them. In your heart.
Yes, absolutely. They were good. I knew they were going to be good movies.
Yeah. Box office has never dictated quality of a movie. It never will.
So. Well, I wish you would have told me that, 3 months ago.
Yeah, Jordan did not have the biggest movie of the year in his top 10. He had it in the honorable mentions and Joyride and Harold the Purple Crayon,
which got delayed till next year.
So.
I'm gonna put it back.
There's
on
always
my
a
list.
Chance next year.
Wait,
next
get a dollar.
It's coming back on my.
I
list.
Hope. I hope. I hope. Jesse, in his honorable mentions, he had The Meg 2, which did turn out to be a real movie after we kind of wondered whether it was real. There had been no preview at the time. Haunted Mansion also, along with a couple other ones, had it in their honorable mentions or above. And a movie that only I saw, I believe, Ruby Gilman, Teenage Kraken, Believe it or not, we
oh my
I
gosh,
laughed
you
a
went,
long time.
You went I, saw that?
Yes, but I have an explanation. Okay. I didn't know that's what I was watching. It was the mystery movie at Regal. Yeah. And I was I just like the idea of the mystery movie, so I'll go every once in a while and just see what comes up on the screen. I slept through the whole thing. It was best nap.
Trick you into seeing is not
the only reason I did it is I was already at the mall. It was movie mystery time, so I went in and slept through that once I saw what it was, and then I went and saw Spider-Verse for the second time right after it.
Yeah, Carly had seen the preview of this movie, too, a couple times, and she described it as, this looks like the worst movie ever made.
Carly's guesting on this show next
time. Yeah, next time. I'm curious if she would have predicted Barbie. Mm-hmm.
She was very excited about Barbie, though. And my wife.
Probably while we were recording that podcast, they were talking about how they want to see Barbie in the other room.
So we need more women on here and more QAnon people, and that will help broaden our base.
Do you know any QAnon women? Because we don't want to replace too many people. We add up these scores.
And I just realized we're giving a prize to the winner. Why isn't there a punishment for the worst score?
Okay, what should the punishment be?
Oh, I don't know, because it's probably me. So.
Yeah, it's you. I was hoping it's... Okay.
You have to watch make up Teenage something Kraken.
Come up with something good.
And you have to stay awake the whole time.
Yeah. Yeah. It's like a Clockwork Orange situation. We'll hold your eyelids open. Jordan's points. He, I don't know if anyone else did the math, but he got a lot of threes, a couple fives in his top 10 here, and got the most points on his list for Transformers at 10 when it was at 9, had 7 points for that. He added up to, I got that 1 point for Barbie, and he ended up with 30 points. So respectable, got up to 30. After a banging start, Cliff just was crushing. Got 2 tens for nailing Spider-Man and Mermaid. Then he got the same 5 for Guardians as Us, a couple 3s, 1 for Transformers, and ends up with 32 points.
Mm.
I will say, Cliff, if you had put Transformers in your top 10, you probably won.
Wow.
You were so close. Mm. So close.
Wrong machine.
Wrong machine. You picked the wrong machine.
Totally did.
I did pretty good. I had I got only ones I didn't get points for in the top 10 were Flash and Fast X. I got I had a lot of threes. Couple fives. Jordan and I's lists were pretty similar. And then I got that 1 for Elemental. So, but like I said, if Elemental would have made $3.5 million, that would have bumped Transformers to the 10th spot. Jordan and I each would have got 6 more points. Jordan would have been in second. I would have been in first by a long shot.
Oh,
$3.5 million. Ooh, somehow it only made $29.5 million in its first weekend, and then took all summer to build up and make me get excited. Somehow Jesse, he nailed Dial of Destiny. I still can't figure out how this math works. What's the difference between his list and mine? We both didn't have something in the top 10.
We both had both of our movies that didn't make the top 10.
Well, what it is
are the same.
Yeah. Huh? Yeah.
Fast
yes,
X
that's
and
true.
The Flash
that's
are both
true.
Not in there. So
yeah. The I think it's really that Hidden Dial of Destiny gave you 3 points, gave you 10 for that. That was your biggest thing. And that was what you thought would be your biggest regret.
Wow, man.
And that put you, I had 33, you had 35.
Unbelievable.
Fortune and glory.
exactly. So wow. I kind of looked at the math and it looked like, if That $3.5 million I would have won. Cliff, if you would have put Transformers up there, you would have won. There's nothing Jordan could have done that the rest of us didn't already do. So
but we were all within five. I didn't trust Barbenheimer. I didn't have either of those movies in the top 10, and I paid for it because that was
But right. Your logic was good. Your logic was good. I listened to that podcast and I agreed with everything you said, and I know what happened.
There was a showdown that I kept talking about on the on the show, not Barbie and Oppenheimer. It was something where we had the list.
It was Elemental and Flash, I think.
Was it? Okay. And Flash didn't even show up for me, and Elemental sort of did.
Yep. It's crazy.
I went and saw both of them that weekend.
Man,
I do want to share just one quote I like just out off the cuff where Jordan said, I was just thinking about Tom Cruise for whatever reason. And that was just a quote I liked. but yeah, despite Cliff using the Gray Sports Almanac in the first few picks, we ended up where we ended up and what it could is, but it all comes down to this. What our winner, first crown the winner, Jesse, the OJ, he did it. He won fair and square. I had a ball, first off. I loved checking the math every week, adding up the scores and watching all these movies and making a game out of it. So first off, I loved it. And I hope we ever have movies again so we can do this again sometime. we had agreed that whoever won gets to pick a movie and the rest of us, you know, if we haven't seen it or whatever, we got to watch it. We're going to talk about it on a future podcast. So do you have something picked out for us?
So, okay. All right. Here's what I'm thinking. All right. I want to throw a big wrench into the whole prize thing.
Uh-oh.
All right. I know we're recording and everything, but here's what's going to happen. All right. So here lately, as you guys know, I've been, if you've seen some of my posts, and I'm probably talked a little bit about it on my podcast, if you're listening, I've been messing with the ChatGPT and artificial intelligence a little bit.
That's true.
Okay.
It's a real crutch.
Oh, all right. All right. Well, hold off now. So how many more episodes of Riverdale do you guys have to watch?
30.
You mean per on as like on the show or like
that,
how
that
many
you guys have to cover?
Okay.
29.
All right. I'm not asking for a timetable or anything like that. The only thing that I'm asking is that I get to talk to you guys after the final episode.
Hmm.
This might be years.
I know. I understand that. That's why I said no timetable. And I threw a prompt into ChatGPT earlier today, and it went a little something like this. I want to do a trivia show about the show Riverdale. Provide me 30 questions, 15 that are going to be somewhat hard and 15 that are going to be hard. And I've already got them ready to go, folks. So what do you say? You guys, as a team, can try to see if you can beat. Because I from what I understand, you guys do a little bit of trivia every once in a while, correct?
Yeah.
Try and beat the machine, not the machine.
The bar trivia guy has never once asked a Riverdale question.
No, he hasn't. So Bert Kreischer, we got to beat Bert.
Come on. What do you say?
Well, we're definitely not opposed to this.
No.
It's not at all. What the agreed?
right.
We'll do both. This. Give us a movie too.
Why not both?
My goodness. Why not both?
You don't have to tempt us or like. Yeah. You don't have Riverdale to bribe us into
was
something.
Not, was not the hard ass.
All I wanted to do was just be like, you know, hey, I respect what you guys are doing with the Riverdale thing, and if I could be a part of it.
Yes.
I would love to be.
We're totally on board with that. That's the thing. But now we want you to pick a movie.
Now I have to do a movie.
Yes. There's rules.
All right. I remember. Okay. All right. So.
And preferably something maybe we haven't seen would be great.
Yeah.
That's another thing that, man. And it's tough because you guys have seen a lot of movies too.
That's true.
So
we saw a bunch this summer, some of us.
You guys actually went to the theater and shit. I mean,
it didn't crazy. Matter. It didn't make us know anything any better than you did.
And I got to try to find something that you guys have access to too. That's the other thing. Like, I want to make sure you guys have access to it.
Yeah. Cliff, don't feel too much pressure, Jesse. We can cut any of this out where you're picking out the movie.
Oh, okay. And then all right. Cliff.
You can just have it. So you just sit there and think about how you're going to pick this.
All right. Well, I know a movie that I used to watch a lot. Well, I'd say a few times there when I was a kid, teenage years.
Yeah.
And you guys may have watched it. I don't know, but I'd like to talk to you guys about it. Let me see if I can find it. It goes by a couple names. Yes.
Yeah. Wow. I don't even know what could that be.
You've heard of this movie, I'm pretty sure. It's got oh my goodness, not Bill Pullman. What's it?
Bill Paxton?
No, not Bill Paxton. Guy from Dumb and Dumber. Dumb and Dumber. I get him mixed up.
Jeff
Daniels. McDermott. Jeff Daniels.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. All right.
Okay.
It was in a time travel movie.
I remember you talking about this.
Yeah.
And I never saw it. You're right. I love this idea.
Movie. Okay. Yes. It goes by two names. It's either Timescape or Grand Tour Disaster in Time, whichever one you want to do. So both of them are the same movie.
Okay, I was going to say, whichever route depends what timeline we go on. Well,
right,
we'll find
right, right.
So there it is. There's my pick. Timescape / Grand Tour Disaster in Time. That's the one I'd love for you guys to. I think that it's on YouTube, if I remember correctly.
That sounds like a Tubi movie.
Yeah, I'm sure it is. I'm sure that it is.
I'm excited. I want to see it.
All right.
Okay.
Because it's nice to have to. I don't have to try to find time. I have to make time.
Right.
That's good.
Right.
Sounds good. All right. So we're going to watch this movie with two names.
Which one are you going to watch?
I don't know. We'll see. Well, that'll be the big surprise when we get back. I watched a movie.
This was a lot of fun, guys. I will tell you that much. I was watching the figures as they rolled in and wondering where I was there towards the end. Mm. So
yeah, it could have went either way there towards the end. Hopefully there's an opportunity to do this again in the future. I know I'm game. I thought everybody had a good showing and had a little fun. It's called making it a little interesting, or you know, put a little wager on there.
This feels like any fantasy sports I've ever played, where no matter how much prep I do, no matter how much I plan ahead, it all just comes down to some whim of fate.
Yep.
And I never know what's going on, and I usually lose.
Yep.
That's why I don't gamble anymore. I used to, and I'm just like, no, I can't do it. Can't do it.
Yep. All right.
Congratulations, Jesse Starcher, on the inaugural crown on the summer box office predictions here at Ka-Pow, the Pop Culture Podcast.
Ooh,
where can
wait.
The folks find you?
Wait. I've got a question here before we sign out here. What do you each predict, just as a little button on this, Aquaman? What is Aquaman going to make? It's a movie. We've just recently got the preview.
Yeah.
It's coming out of Christmas. What we just saw Flash.
What did Flash make? 50 something?
It made 100 and some, but 50 the first weekend.
What did Blue Beetle make? Like 60 something? 70?
I don't know. I don't even know. Okay. Something like that. 30 the first weekend. Mm-hmm. And maybe not even that much, but what are you thinking? Wallets in theaters.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of discussion about the cinematic universe for DC still after the summer hit.
Well, and there's also the whole Amber Heard
right
problem.
That's kind of hanging over things too.
Very Flash-esque. Some people are going to go see it because of her.
But man, you got Momoa.
You got Aquababy, and that's the big lingering question.
You got Patrick Wilson. It's a real tangoed cash situation.
Shirtless Momoa is going to bring in folks, I know. But that, yeah, that first movie was a huge success. It was right. a billion-dollar movie. It was right there mm-hmm. when every superhero movie was blown out of the water. No pun intended. My man. So, but I think we're in a different world right now, and Aquaman's just, again, bad luck when it was scheduled, where DC is like winding down the whole connected universe they started, and this will be the last one. So it's going to be way lower than the first one, but I think it'll do better than these last couple. So I was 155.
155. Jesse, what do you say?
I'll say 100. I'll just keep it at 100. I don't know, man. I just feel like there is a lot to worry about with this film, but I don't know what else is going to be going on in December either.
Well, that's the whole thing. Not much. What's it up against? You know, that what else is right.
there? There'll be something, but,
I'm going with 100. I'm keeping it 100.
100. Keeping it 100. Cliff?
I'll bid $1, Bob.
Okay, $1.
Gosh. And we're talking about its entire run, not just...
Yeah, well, it's in theaters, yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
Which probably won't be long.
Domestically. Mm-hmm, domestically. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Mm, I don't... I don't know that it does 150.
You can take the 101 cent.
Yeah. I don't know. I'll say.
Wasn't it shirtless? I'll say 80.
Yeah.
80.
Yeah.
Wow.
I think it's going to be good. But
wasn't
not that good apparently.
Wasn't Shirtless Momoa part of Fast X?
Yes.
Probably. They should have done Shirtless Brie Larson. Anything would have helped.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know whether to go because I really feel like Jordan is the closest. I feel strongly about that. I don't know if I'd go that high.
Here's the thing.
I don't know.
If they're doing the storyline that I think and a lot of people think they're going to do, then right. I can see a lot of people having a big problem with that and going, oh, I'm not going to go watch that. I'm not going to let that be a part of, you know, even as a fictionalized thing.
Yeah, I saw some article about, like, test audiences walking out of Aquaman, like, because of something.
Oh, my gosh.
So, yeah, if they are doing what you imply they're doing, and yeah. I think I know what you're implying they're thinking they're doing.
I have no idea. But I'm now going to say 140. Wow. I'm going with 140.
Hopefully they learn from the test audiences then. I mean, to at least...
Well, that would be possible. A hard thing to cut out.
I don't know what storyline this is.
Oh, man. That big of a... Wow. Okay.
All right. Well, sorry. Cut you off. What's your... How can people find you, Jesse?
Oh, yeah. At Source MattCast on X/Twitter. If you want to reach out to me there, we talk comics on the Source Material Comics podcast. And you should be able to find that feed on any podcatcher out there. Right now, we're doing with Source Material. Usually that's me and Mark. We sit down and we record our discussion about 3 comic books. And we just finished up our DC trilogy with Brian Azzarello's that was Luther, Man of Steel, which was really good. We're getting ready to talk crossovers. You guys do those on here every once in a while. Ping pongs were involved from ping pong balls and stuff.
I still have a box up.
We're about ready to get into crossovers. And
a regular first... Mr. Moose over here, if anyone gets that reference. You know, does anyone know what I'm talking about? Mr. Moose?
Mr. Moose?
Cliff?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, Captain okay. Kangaroo.
Captain Kangaroo, right. Ping pong balls, guys. Come
okay,
on.
All right. So, yeah, you could check that out. We're getting ready to get into a new trilogy there of crossovers. I know Elvira meets Vincent Price. We talk about that. Power Rangers go up against Godzilla. I think that's the first book that we're going to be talking about, which really, I liked it. I thought it fit really well. 90s comics. Unspoken Issues is also on that feed. You can check that out. We got a great one coming up this coming Monday where Chris Armstrong and I talk about Supreme number 3 and Bloodstrike number 5. And you guys probably have no idea what happens in those issues, but they were both key issues for Chris and I because of the amount of gore that happened and just blew our minds when we were kids. So check that out as well. I mentioned artificial intelligence. I do a show called AI Writes here lately where I throw a prompt into ChatGPT and it's usually comic book related. And then we kind of see what comes up there. So we had a recent episode, which was, I don't know, man, I don't know how to gauge these things, but we went on a tangent at one point in a conversation on a podcast about Boomerang and his civil rights being civil liberties being violated because he got thrown into a superpowered cell. And I had AI come up with a 3-issue story about how Matt Murdock would represent him and what things would happen. And it kind of got funny. My favorite one so far is the Spectre as the health inspector for Subway. I'll just put it that way. That's my favorite one I've done.
The health inspector.
Yes, he was called the Spectre. So anyway, that's it, guys. I appreciate you having me on here tonight.
Awesome. Good stuff. I just had a comic come out. We went to the Mothman Festival, debuted the Moth number 1 from SoPro Comics. You can find that at soprocomics.com. I'm proud of it. It's a fun book. There's the Mothman mythology into a crazy sci-fi story. So check that out. Anybody else want to plug something?
I think I saw Elvira meets Vincent Price on Cinemax one night a long time ago.
I'm just glad we don't have to watch any Steve Guttenberg.
It was on my list.
Cliff Gross with Tower of Terror.
Tower of Terror was on my list.
Man.
Thank you, Jesse. All right, we will see you shortly. My name is Jordan Lowe.
Cliff Barnes.
Seth. Bye forever.
Ka-Pow, the pop cultured podcast, is intended for entertainment and information purposes only. Sounds, music, and clips played during the podcast are property of copyright holders. All original content is property of www.udownwithkpp.com. If you enjoyed this podcast, please subscribe and leave a comment. Ka-Pow, the pop cultured podcast, can be found on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Podbean, Spotify, and wherever podcasts can be found. You can connect with us through social media on Facebook, YouTube, at the Ka-Pow Podcast on Twitter, or email the show, Ka-Pow, the pop cultured podcast, at gmail.com. If you really want to go the extra mile, join our Patreon at patreon.com/udamwithkpp for special content and access to Patreon-only benefits. We are grateful for anyone who chooses to contribute, but please know that most of our content will remain free. So please continue to like, comment, and share.